If I could turn back time, if I could find a way, I'd take back those words that are hurt. I don't know why I did the things I did.
Well, we can turn back the clock, and with the aid of film and photography, we can take a look back in time. With the ending of the war to end all wars the previous year, and the signing of the peace treaty in Versailles just 21 days before this photograph was taken, a monument to those killed and wounded during the Great War was also unveiled in Whitehall in London on this same day. Along with many other towns and villages throughout the country, Stillington took time to celebrate the coming of peace. Here we have a scene where Stillington residents celebrate with a party, hosted by Squire Liddell at Stillington Hall on the 19th of July 1919. In this next image, taken at the same time, we see people in Red Cross uniform and also the local Boy Scouts. The children with the donkey in the foreground are Charlie Thompson on the right, holding the donkey. His brother Bert is sitting on the donkey, and a boy called Masterman is holding the donkey on the left side. Both Bert and Charlie feature prominently in the 1937 images, which will follow later. Bert's family still live in Stillington. Their elder brother, Harry Thompson, was killed in action in France less than 1 year earlier, on the 14th of March 1918, aged just 21. And he is commemorated on the Town Cot Memorial in Belgium and on the Village Memorial in St Nicholas Church. Here is a picture of Harry on the left with his brother Don on the right and their sisters Mary and Mabel. From a 1932 newspaper cutting, shows children from the parish outside Wellington House. These annual parties at Wellington House were given by sisters Mrs. Newman and Miss Maskell, who ran the premises as a nursing home. And it looks as though the children had to take their own mugs for a drink. The first one, we see residents on the bank side at the T-junction with Car Lane. God Save the King and a flag also appear on the bank. The parade makes its way up High Street with this fully loaded lorry belonging to the Scaife family. And coming past the church is our King and Queen in the royal carriage. Next we have a cinefilm of the coronation of King George VI, which also included the crowning of the village May Queen. This George was the second son of King George V and not expected to inherit the throne. He spent most of his early years in the shadow of his elder brother Edward, who ascended the throne as King Edward VIII. But less than a year later, Edward declared that he wanted to marry the American divorced socialite Wallis Simpson. Prime Minister Stanley Baldwin advised him that for political and religious reasons he could not possibly marry Mrs. Simpson and remain king. So Edward abdicated in order to marry her, and George ascended the throne as the third monarch of the House of Windsor. This cinefilm was shot on 9.5mm film by Fred Baker, who owned an electrical shop in the marketplace at Easingworld. Fred lived at Marton with his sister. But before that, we have some still images with names of some of the people who can also be seen in the cinefilm. This image was taken in the Hall stable yard. It shows Roger Kerrison, Algy Richardson and Charlie Thompson preparing a battleship and a lighthouse to go on the town pond. The carriage for the King and Queen belonged to Squire Liddell, who was the owner of Stillington Hall. The Hall Yard is now a courtyard development of detached houses at the east end of South Back Lane. And here we have their work proudly displayed on the town pond. Of course, a coronation needs a king or a queen. Here we have the king, who was Trot Nolson, and his queen, Algy Richardson. Algy was the father of Olga Midgley, and one of Stillington's most colourful characters. The carriage prepares to leave the village green with the May Queen following behind. In the background is Woodville House. In this lineup we have, from left to right, William Howland, Buster Scaife, Algy Richardson, Trot Nolson, Billy Burnett, Charlie Thompson and Bert Thompson. Here we have in the foreground Les Morland and on horseback Bert Thompson, George Manson and Ian McCartney. Les Morland was married to Rosa, who still lives in High Street. The procession is about to leave the front of Stillington Hall. Leaving the hall gates, we have Margaret Avril, the schoolteacher's daughter, who is the May Queen, and Peggy North, her lady-in-waiting. The train bearers are Rosa Morland and Muriel Spruce. In this image of the 1937 celebrations is Madge Gibson and her sister Mildred Smith, with the donkey and trap. Madge now lives on Parkfield with her son Clifford and daughter Kathleen. And now the cinephone by Fred Baker. Here we see Raymond Souter and Jeff Metcalf setting out on their bikes from what is now the chapel to deliver the coronation souvenir booklets. As the parade makes its way down Main Street, in the foreground, dressed in white, we see Les Hutchinson playing the drum. Les was killed just 3 years later on the 23rd of May 1940 during the Battle of Crete, and he is commemorated on the Portsmouth Naval Memorial. Les was a very talented musician and his family took an active part in village life. The treble bell in Stillington Church was recast in his honour. This little girl. All will be revealed at the end of the film. Stillington tries to return to normal after 6 long years of war with Germany. Unfortunately, not many images of this time have become available to us. This first photograph shows children lined up at the back of the village hall to be judged for the fancy dress. The sweep in the foreground won 10 shillings. In today's money, that's 50p. A trip to Scarborough. This image shows children collecting their half crowns from Harold Hardy, who was the landlord of the White Bear, assisted by Colin Kay, who lived in Woodside Cottage. In the foreground we can see Dennis Law. These outings to Scarborough for the village children became an annual summer event. In this image we see the children rushing to get on the Reliance coaches. Next we have a few images of the 1953 coronation. Unfortunately not many photographs of the coronation have become available. First image, the parade heads down Main Street. At the rear, with the wheelbarrow cleaning up the mess left by the elephant, is Fred Kitson. Leading the elephant is Algie Richardson. And the boy on the bicycle is Victor Howland, who now lives at Oak Tree Sawmills at Hewby. Here is Jacko Downs standing proudly with his horse. On the lorry from left to right are Roger Kerrison, Albert Cook, Charlie Thompson, Tom Scaife and George Scaife. Barney and Hardy refers to Bob Barningham, landlord of the White Dog, now the Gulshan, and stepfather of the late Stan Nesbitt, and Harold Hardy, landlord of the White Bear. Harold was Val Sparrow's dad. Missing is the name of the landlord of the bay horse, Frank Betteridge. Apparently, George Scaife had fallen out with Frank and was barred from the bay horse. And so in retaliation, George Scaife refused to put Frank's name on the side of his lorry. Nothing changes. Now onto a film of the 1977 Silver Jubilee and Ox Roast. This occasion marked 25 years since the accession to the throne for Queen Elizabeth. Sit back and see how many people you can recognise. With narration by Dennis Law and Don Brown.
The 1977 Jubilee Ox Roast. Mr. Ian Richards, a local farmer, had the idea of having an ox roast to complement the forthcoming celebrations. He made several inquiries up and down the country, looking for information, and help was received from one or two quarters and decided, with support from the committee, to go ahead. I was approached for ideas in making a spit. My experience of roasting was a slice of bread on the open fire. However, I slept in the project, as one does, and being involved in agricultural engineering most of my life, I had some good contacts in that field. Messrs. G. Long, Yorkshire Tractors, and Paul Seward, I had a rough idea of what was wanted. I begged, borrowed, and scrounged from these firms. None are in business anymore. The spit was 3.5 inches diameter water pipe, 13 foot long, and iron frame from Long's. The grate was made from concaves, from Yorkshire Tractors and bearing gears, etc. from Seward's. These items were brought together at Mr. Frank Atkinson's Abbey Farm, Martin, in the grain store, where, with the aid of Peter Bellwood, Brian Harrison and myself, the bits and pieces were cut and welded together into some sort of shape. I found a small electric motor and gearbox to drive the spit at about 2 RPM. The fireplace was built of concrete blocks about